with the help of technology in the form of digital learning tools that we use today, workplace learning has absolutely transformed, undergone a significant shift, especially over the last couple of years since the pandemic, okay, where technology has played a critical role in terms of engaging talent, keeping them motivated, okay, and helping them acquire new skills, which are important to help organizations prepare for the future. Many organizations are still, yet to commit to technology use in learning and embrace the full potential from a digital learning point of view. And when it comes to learners, if you see, okay, story isn't that very different. Okay, as the world starts to get back to normalcy, we all, you know, most of us have started going back to office, meetings, started traveling and all of those. Okay, our desire to learn through that in-person setup that we have been so used to in the past has started growing again. But the real question that we are going to touch upon today is that can organizations, given the benefits and given the current environment of a hybrid work environment, ignore technology from a learning point of view? Okay. With that context, I'm really excited to be hosting this session today with our panel of esteemed industry speakers and to dive deeper, debate with some hard-hitting questions. Okay. So what is the best way to implement learning strategies for the workplace 2.0? Is providing Netflix-like intuitive platform the solution to what we are seeing today? Does it help? You know, does technology help to enthuse learners and consume, help them consume content, and much, much more?
And I define learning organization as an organization which learns from its success, which learns from its failures, learns from its experiences, and how they can leverage this learning for better performance of the organization is very, very important. If you recall, around 1985 to 92, this was the period of DVD rentals, right? And Blockbuster was in a big way. They were the champions of this DVD rental market in US. And they were going very, very strong. And I think by 92, they were from one rental store, they had made around 2,800 rental stores in Dallas. From Dallas, they started, and across the globe, actually, not only in the US, across the globe, they could have 2,800 rental stores. That company, which was a champion of DVD rentals, and then they fell off. The CEO of Netflix, you know, actually there was a time when he approached Blockbuster, can we partner together in this race? You know, we talk about competition, here was a case of a co-optation. Okay, so they wanted to cooperate together and take a share of the market, which very clearly the Blockbusters refused. Blockbusters were bankrupt. They went into bankruptcy and they had a $1 billion loss. And the reverse was true for Netflix. I think 2018, they said that they were $165 billion company. How did it all happen? And I think the crux of it is all into how they learned the situation better, how they applied technology more, how they took into account the various disruptions that was required at that time. And last but not the least, what Blockbuster did not realize, the customer delight, and how the things, the technology was changing quickly into the bandwidths were increasing, and people were using those bandwidths. They forgot that there is a new technology emerging and the learning could happen in a little different way. And also, it is no more a retail business. Blockbuster thought it's a retail business, like a brick and mortar business, but it did not happen like that. That business model was changing to home entertainment. It changed the way people started thinking. They got a lot of choice, a lot of disruptions that, you know, I will say it was not only technology, also the risk-taking ability of Netflix. That according to that, they changed themselves. They got into that same business. We modified that same business and then adopted certain technologies on the streams, and then applied it on their customers. If you are not able to adopt technology under the opportune moment, you get wiped off. So competition is watching you. The secret of success is how good a learning organization you are, how you can learn from your success. Again, as I said, how you can learn from your failures and learn from your experiences and how the environment is shaping. shaping. If you are able to adapt to that situation, you have created a great organization.
But overall, if I look at it, I think hybrid is the word you used for the way workplace is going. In my view, I don't think it's going to be 100% technology-based training. It is going to be a hybrid. And I think that was an acceptance, at least in HR folks, before COVID struck, that we have to move to e-learning, we have to move to using technology, but it has to be in a hybrid way. It has to be intertwined with physical contact, because learning with through peers, through interactions, through networking is an important. I can share an example with you. We recently launched a program called Leading Out of Crisis for our leadership team, and we did it in a hybrid way. And I know that when we were doing the online modules, there was a feel that there has to be that personal touch. There has to be that interaction. The energy is not the same if we are not, not together in a room. So if it is about basic skill development, possibly yes. But when we're talking about some of the areas like competency, behaviors, learning from each other, we will need to go back to the classroom.
Start with an example. More retail has been there for the last 14 odd years. And we have a 14,000 front-end workforce spread across 11 states. And the entire manner of training was physical. And then the pandemic happened, and we shifted to a complete e-learning based approach. And when I traveled to the stores across geographies, the amount of interest that's there in our front-end employees to pick up stuff and to learn is tremendous. So what I think has happened is that technology has democratized learning. It happened to all of us in urban areas 10 years back. It's now happening to people in smaller towns and cities. The entire thing has got democratized. So people who have the energy and passion and aspiration will leverage what's available and move faster.
Online scenario, that also needs to be somehow made interactive. So be it like, you watch a small video, you answer a small quiz, you have a, puzzle to solve, or a drag and drop, or, any of those things which actually makes the user engage with the platform. And here I would say, one of the key things which has worked very well for us, we've been in this journey for a long time now. And like most of our other organizations, the pandemic has only accelerated that technology adoption. What has really worked for us is a combination of offline motivation and online content relevance, coupled with strategies like gamification and some of the related aspects that we do. So creating a leaderboard, for example, who has completed how many sorts of learning. So you try to generate interest and competition amongst the learning community themselves, be it a specified group of middle managers or top leaders or others. And then you create offline offshoots of those learning where people actually meet in a physical setting whenever possible, or at least through offline forums, and share the learnings. And you find, supplement that with, actual projects in the workplace, which helps you, implement or, see the practical side of what you learn. So, for example, if you're doing a course on data analytics, you're learning Python, R, or all those, technologies, what is there. You actually take up one of the problems that you have. It could be a very small thing, like, if you're a, let's say, an IT or an IT enabled service organization, address the problem of attrition. Apply those technologies like, how can you use this, latest, programming languages, and then how do you create predictive modeling out of it? That makes it more relevant for, people to learn. And bear in mind, when you're especially addressing middle to senior workforce, they have had their own share of experience over the last 5, 10, 15 years in the company or elsewhere. So grabbing their attention is even more challenging. Because the first thing when you say, and I experienced this firsthand, when we thought, it's a good idea for, digital upskill of the organization. Initially, the response was, I would say, to some extent lukewarm. And some people actually struggled sitting in a class to learn a new technology. But the moment you connected that with an actual problem they have on the floor, then that interest came back manifold.
There is too much talk about technology and too little talk about content. If I ask all of us to think about when was the last great learning experience we had or the last shoddy learning experience we had, most likely we will say things like great facilitator, meaningful content, some practical insights, and I could use it in my job. We would rarely say technology was not very good, it was not easy to access, I had this issue, I had that issue, right? So technology is just a vehicle, it's a medium to supply the content and engage with the audience, but ultimately it's the content and the facilitation and the relevance of what we are telling that is important for the user, right? For example, you say we could talk about Netflix, right? You can put a pathetic TV show on Netflix, it will still be pathetic and people will still not see it, right? Netflix sells not because of the platform, but because it generates great content all the time and a variety of content which people can relate to, different people can relate to, right? So I would say that as we design, as HR leaders and HR professionals, if we have to design our learning experience journey, I think we should start with, yes, what is the most meaningful content I need to design? Number one. Second is, what is the most engaging way to deliver it? And that has to be adapted to the technology, because when you are in a classroom, you might still bear with the content and learn something because you're sitting there for 2 hours. In an online setting, you will probably switch off in 10 seconds. And I'll tell you about the YouTube videos, right? When you have this skip ad button that comes out 5 seconds, that 5 seconds is eternity. And by, you know, destiny, you have to watch 30 seconds of ad, you will never watch that video, right? So you have to catch attention quickly. So content has to be interesting. And then thirdly, in the application, you know, we all know about Ebbing Ross forgetting curve. 40% of learning is forgotten in the first 3 days. So then we should have focus on applicable insights and some kind of follow-up to make sure people are practicing those. So if the technology is easy to access, which is the technology, great content, and engaging to deliver, that's the recipe, I believe, of a great learning experience, rather than only great technology and average content. I would need to have average technology with great content rather than great technology with average content.